Good morning, church. I've entitled this morning's sermon, The Voice Behind Thee, The Word Within Thee. I am in Luke chapter 24, verse 13 through 27. Please stand if you're able for the reading of the word. Luke 24, verse 13 through 27. And behold, two of them were going that very day to a village named Emmaus. Speaking of who? Jesus' disciples, two of them. Which was about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things which had taken place. And while they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself approached and began traveling with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are these words that you are exchanging with one another as you are walking?" And they stood still looking, and said, one of them, Cleopas, answered and said to him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and unaware of the things which have happened in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "The things about Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty indeed, and word, and in the sight of God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to the sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, it is the third day since these things happened. But also some women among us amazed us when they were at the tomb early in the morning, and they did not find his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just exactly as the women who also said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, "Oh, foolish men, and slow of heart to believe in all the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and to enter into his glory?" Then beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in the scriptures. Please be seated. You see, Jesus is risen from the dead.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Jesus is risen from the dead.
Hallelujah.
He's alive. But they don't know it yet, do they? So he draws near to hear his own disciples talk about all that had happened. See, the gospel is there within them as they continue to testify to one another of all that happened. See, they're walking along the way and they're having a conversation about all the things that happened and everything. And what are they really discussing? They don't realize it yet. They're discussing the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel of God, amen? Yet it's not coupled yet with faith. It's not coupled yet with hope, nor the awesome love of God, and it's absent the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. You got to wonder what Jesus would see and hear from us today, wouldn't you? If he was to hide himself from us and draw alongside of us during the day, as we walk along the way, I wonder what kind of conversations we would have and what he would hear from us. For him to come truly walk beside us and to understand what we really believe, and what lives deep down inside of our hearts. Wonder what things he would find in us. Look at Isaiah 30, 18 through 21. It says, "Therefore the Lord longs to be gracious to you, and therefore he waits on high to have compassion on you. For the Lord is a God of justice. How blessed are all those who long for him." You longing for the Lord? Wouldn't it be wonderful if the Lord came back right now? Would it?
Amen.
Well, why does he tarry?
He wants no one to perish.
Say it again.
He wants that no one should perish.
No one should perish.
O people in Zion, inhabiting Jerusalem, you will weep no longer. He will surely be gracious to you at the sound of your cry. And when he hears it, he will answer you. Although the Lord has given you bread of privation and water of oppression, he, your teacher, will no longer hide himself. But your eyes will behold your teacher, and your ears will hear a word behind you saying what? This is the way. Walk in it whenever you turn to the right or to the left. Isn't that what you want? I mean, really, truly, in life right now, isn't that what you want? Don't you really want to hear the Lord saying behind you what? This is the way. Walk in it. Do this, right? True? So often this is what we want. To literally hear the Lord behind us speaking and directing our every move and our every decision. To hear his audible voice say, "What are these things that you are discussing as you walk along the way?" What are these things in you? I remember Julie and I were at a point in our life that I had to make a decision whether or not I was going to remain in the military or if I was going to get out. And we were really struggling with it. We had the opportunity to take a set of orders to Arizona. And I was really struggling with this, but I began to pray and to seek God. And I will never forget this conversation that the Lord and I had, and it kind of went like this. I was like, Lord, I don't know what to do. I don't know whether to remain in the military or go to Arizona or to get out and remain here. And you know what he said to me? He goes, so what do you want to do? And I'm like, but Lord, I need you to tell me what to go. He goes, well, let's ask this question. If you remain in the military and you continue to serve me, will you do that? Will you continue to honor me where you're at? I was like, Lord, you know that I will. And he goes, and if you decide to go to Arizona, will I be with you there? And I'm like, Lord, you've been with me everywhere. And if you get out of the military and you remain here, will you remain true to me? Will you continue to serve me? And I'm like, Lord, you know that I will. He says, so what do you want to do? Sometimes we know the right to do, right? And if God is really with us, if he's really living inside of it, it doesn't really matter where we go. What matters, are we going to serve God? The voice is there. And speaking to you is there in a much wonderful way now, other than being directly behind you. Amen? Don't turn your heart from this. Don't turn your mind from this. You know what you really believe. You know what you really believe. And what you know what's there deep in your heart. And so does Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? The disciples, as they're walking, they don't even know this guy. True? They're hidden. Jesus is hidden, but they don't even know this guy. And he asked them this question. What is this? Did they hide it from him? What did they share with him? Exactly which was, I think somebody said that this morning. You don't have to be a theologian, do you, Wayne? Huh? As you're walking along the way, and you run into situations where you have an opportunity to share what God has done in your life, do it. Share those. Don't be ashamed of it. Share with what has happened, right? Because that's exactly what the disciples are doing right now. Look what he does. Look what Jesus does as they confess to him what they know and think in their hearts. He speaks to them of himself. He reminds them of the written word, only this time in the fulfillment of it. And as they hear Jesus expound upon all the scriptures and the fulfillment of them within himself, their hearts are kindled with true flames of fire. The word burns inside of them. And the fire within them, it's about to spread. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The fire within them, the word is there inside of them, and they don't even what? They don't even realize it. Do you realize that the gospel of God, the gospel of Jesus Christ, carries with it the Spirit of God? The very Word of God is full of the Spirit. You can't get away from it. Amen. And so here's the thing, right? You share the gospel with someone who does not know Christ, guess what they're getting whether they realize it or not? They don't know it. They haven't realized it yet until it comes what? Alive in them. But that doesn't mean you're not faithful to what? To share it. Share what's really in your heart. Share what you really believe about the Lord. Amen? God's Word is faithful. It will not return to him void. You may say, well, Chuck, is returning to me void. No, it's not. We talked about this a couple weeks. How long did it take for you to come to Christ?
Way too long.
Way too long. I love that, Wayne. Way too long. And for me, to me personally, the few years that I was alive seems like an eternity of how long I was away from the Lord. But now I've spent more years as a Christian than I ever was as a non-Christian. And those years have gone by, but the reality is, does it really matter? How long you been a Christian? Come on, yeah, I'm looking for opportunity and I'm looking for participation today. How long have you been a Christian? How long?
2 years.
2 years.
42
years. 42 years.
52
years.
35.
35 years. 72 years. You've been a Christian for that long. Here's the beauty of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Here's the absolute beauty of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter how long you've been in the field. What matters is that you're in the field. We all get paid the same what? Grace. We all get paid the same salvation. We all get paid the same love, the same forgiveness. The point is, get into the field. And we celebrate with that. From 72 to 2 years to 6 months, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how long. The point is what? The gospel of Jesus Christ still works. The gospel of God still works. The word is alive and it is active. And the word is fixing to spread in this moment. I mean, if you realize this and you look at this whole situation, you know the fire spread to you. For how many years ago? How long has this been now since this occurrence happened with the road to Emmaus? How long ago was that? 2,000 years. That's a long time. Longer than 72, Lloyd. Amen? That's not to pick on Lloyd. It's just that we think our lives are so long and it's a drop in the bucket compared to eternity. Amen? What we need is not to understand ourselves better. You don't need to understand yourself better. What you need to understand is Jesus better. You need to understand Him better. Even as Jesus spoke to them of the words of the prophets, even as He opened their minds and hearts to understand all that was written and the fulfillment of it, they still didn't fully comprehend until Jesus revealed Himself to them. You understand what I'm saying? Here's the point. As they're walking along the road, and Jesus comes up to them and He begins to explain Himself and who He is in the Scripture and begins to open their minds and their hearts to the Word of God, guess what they still don't get? The full comprehension of it. Until when? Until you go a little bit further and He's fixing to leave and they say, no, come on inside and have supper with us. And so then He sits down at table with them and what does He do? He breaks the bread and then what happened? Their eyes were open, they realized that, oh my. Oh my, He's alive. What those women said was true. I'm not sitting at home. We got to go tell. We got to go tell them. Well, they already heard once. Wait. Stop, James. Oh, man. What? Do I really have to keep sharing the gospel with people? They've already heard it once. Oh, I've heard it. I've heard it all. I've read it. I understand the gospel. I don't need to study that book anymore. Yes, you do. Because every day that you come to it, if you're really open to it, you'll learn something new. You'll learn something more about Christ. You'll learn something more about who you are. More importantly, who He is and how He wants to lead you in the paths of righteousness for His own name's sake. Amen?
Sir. I had an elderly lady one time, I approached her and I said, "You missed you in Sunday school. We'd really love to have you come and join us in Sunday school." And she looked at me and she said, very seriously, she says, "I don't need to come to Sunday school. I already know it." And I looked her back in the eye and I said, "Well, then you should be teaching Sunday school."
That's great. You know my favorite story was talking about fellowship, right? Two things, really. One, the Lord revealed to me not long ago. You get these people who say, "Well, I don't need to go to church. I can go celebrate with God up on the mountain. And, you know, I'll go out fishing and everything. And I'll go do all those things. And God will be with me. And I'm out there worshiping." Well, I got to remind you, what happened to Moses when he went up on the mountain? Did he stay up there? No, where did he go? Why? Look, if you're really getting close to God and you really are getting close to God out there in the field and everything, I don't got no problem with that, all right? But I promise you one thing. When you get up there on the field, He's going to send you right back to what He really loves, and that's people. You can't get away from that. He's going to send you right back to be involved with people to share with them what you learned up on the mountain, amen? True? Even if you resist it. And Moses certainly did, didn't he? Didn't he? Oh, Jesus loves you. He loves you and He loves everybody else in your life. Amen? My other favorite story about fellowship and about being involved in church is, you know the one about the farmer? Right? He was out there and he gathered up all his brush and everything. He brought all the logs and everything. What do they do nowadays? They still do it, right? They set it on fire. That's what they do. They set it on fire. They burn it up. So the pastor went out to visit the farmer and he walks up and this guy's burning all this junk, right? Pastor didn't say a word to him. Just walked up and grabbed one of those sticks and started playing with a coal in the fire. And he scooted it away from all the other coals. And all of a sudden, pretty soon, the coal started to what? Died, was going down. And then he took that coal and he scooted it back in amongst the fire. And immediately what happened? Boom, man, it sparked right back up. He did that 3 times and that farmer said, "All right, Pastor, I get it. I'll be in church on Sunday." Amen. You need fellowship.
Yes.
You need it. It is vital to you. And more importantly to me, I mean that most emphatically. You don't realize how important it is for you to fellowship with other Christians. Because I got to tell you, your life and your ministry is not about you. Your life and your ministry is not about you. Who's it about? Oh, so often we as Christians, we fail to see what we give and how we inspire other people to continue going on. It's so easy not to come to church anymore. Oh, I get nothing out of it. That's because you're not getting anything in it. Amen? Get involved. Let it get involved in you. Amen? The fire, coupled with Jesus' words and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, will kindle a fire in you. I promise you that. Therefore, we need to understand Jesus better and for Him to reveal Himself and His Father to us. John 17:1-3, Jesus spoke these things and lifted up His eyes to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come, glorify Your Son." Where's He going? Amen. So He's going to bring glory to His Father by what? Going to the cross. "Glorify Your Son, that the Son may glorify You. Even as You gave Him authority over all flesh, that to all whom You have given Him, He may give" what? "Eternal life." Do you want that? "Then this is eternal life, that they may know You, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom You have sent." There is eternal life. You want eternal life? That's it. You got to know who? You got to know Jesus, and you also have to know who? The Father. You need to know Him. You need to understand Him. Because He certainly understands you. And He knows what's best for you. And where He wants you to be, and what He wants you to do, what He wants you to put your heart and mind to, and everything in your life. Amen? How does He do that, Chuck? The same way He did it to His disciples who were on the road to Emmaus. The Word within them. See, it was already there. The very Word of God is alive. The Word of God is active, and it is there within you. Look at Hebrews 4:12-13. "For the Word of God is living." Now, who is the Word? How do we know this? Because John told us so. Amen? John did. He said, what? He was the Word. He was the Word. "For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. And it pierces as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart." Jesus knows. The Holy Spirit knows what you really think and believe in your heart. He understands your intentions. He knows what's really going on. "And there is no creature hidden from His sight." Nothing. "But all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of Him with whom we have to do." John 6:62-69. "What then if you see the Son of Man ascending to where He was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits" what? Man, if you were in Sunday school today, we're all over that this morning, weren't we? Huh? "But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who did not believe and who it was who would betray Him. And He was saying, 'For this reason, I have said to you that no one can come to Me unless it has been granted to him from the Father.'" I got to stop here for a moment. I know this as well as you do, that I have loved ones in my life and you have loved ones in your life right now that maybe do not know the Lord. Or maybe they should know the Lord, and you've presented the Word to them, and God has presented the Word to them, but they refuse to what?
Believe.
Every man, every woman, you all have a choice, don't you? So do they. As much as I sometimes want to live life for other people, I can't. I can't do it. You can't do it. As much as you want to accept Christ for them, you can't. They have to believe it and accept it for themselves and come into agreement with God. Does this make sense? Amen. And we continue to do just as God loves us, right? I mean, because I wasn't a fan of God before I came to Him. Were you? Come on, we were in rejection of Him as well until we came to the what? To the light, to the knowledge of Him. So Jesus said to the 12, let me back up, verse 66, as a result of this, many of His disciples withdrew and were not walking with Him anymore. So Jesus said to the 12, you do not want to go away also, do you? And Simon Peter answered Him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have believed and come to know that You are the Holy One of God. What an awesome confession. Don't come to Chuck Snyder. Don't come to any of those mega preachers or ministers out there. Don't come to them. Don't come to them. You come to Christ. If you don't get anything else out of this sermon, do not follow man. Follow Christ. Follow the Lord. I will always point you to Him because He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. He will always lead you in what is right. He will always lead you in what is truth. Amen?
Amen.
No matter what the world says.
Amen.
No matter what the world says, He will always lead you in what is right. I believe this with all my heart. Where else can we go, Lord? I have to come to Him. He's the one who reveals Himself to us. He's the one who reveals our hearts to us. He's the one who reveals the heart of the Spirit to you. He's the one that speaks to you and tells you the way to go and how to walk. Amen? Nothing has changed. The words, as He explained to His disciples as they were walking along the road to Emmaus, in the Greek is dianogia, a great word. You know what it means? It means to fully open that which was closed. So as He began to explain Himself and the Word of God to them and how it represented Him in the Scriptures, you know what He was doing to them? He was fully opening their minds and their hearts to who? And they became fully cognizant of the truth of what was being said in the Scripture of Christ. See, when Jesus opens your mind and hearts to His Word and the things of Him, it's not a partial opening. He opens it up to you fully so that you have full comprehension, so that you have full understanding in those things of Himself. He reveals Himself to you, and look what it will do to you. Look what it will do to you. When you finally get home, what did it do to the disciples? Did they go, oh, let's just crash out for the night. We'll stay at home. What did it do to them? I got to tell you, man, they were so excited. They couldn't wait. They got up, you know. I mean, I don't know what it's like to run 7 miles. I've never done that. Have you? Some people are marathon people. What's it like to run 7 miles? I got no clue. I've done a mile and a half. I've done two. I've even done three. I've never done seven. Go ahead.
Well, if you're not ready, it'll kill you. But if you're ready, it's a joy. It's fun. It's exhilarating.
I believe it. But I don't know why I got this vision of Wayne laying down on the ground with foam coming out of his mouth and everything because he's, you know, been running 7 miles and he's not ready for it. But something made them ready. Something set their hearts on fire to make them run 7 miles. You got to understand. I sometimes I find a lot of humor in Scripture. And this one event is very humorous to me for some reason. The fact is that they went all the way to Emmaus. They run all the way back to Jerusalem. They get inside the house. They start telling them, and guess who appears? Like that. It's like they had to run 7 miles. Jesus, just, He was there. And they're like, really? Can you imagine? Really? That's how I would react, you know, really? Well, couldn't you have just translated us over there too? Wouldn't that be great? You know, why wouldn't you just take us with you? But the gospel message is alive now in them. The gospel message of Jesus' resurrection is alive. All of a sudden, it's affecting them. It's making them do things they never thought they'd do. Who think that you would be running 7 miles to go share the gospel with somebody? Huh? We can't even go 2 steps next to our neighbor. Amen. Look, those disciples' hearts are full of blaze. They don't walk back to Jerusalem, they run. They can't wait to tell others of Jesus and their new understanding of who He is. And the word within them is fulfilled. And it's an amazing thing because it happens all the time. It happens all the time. Someone who's been living in the dark life and everything their whole life, and all of a sudden they hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. It comes to live in them. They come to Christ. They get all born again. And all of a sudden, all of their friends are calling them what? Oh, you're a holy roller. You're a Bible thumper. Yeah, I am. I'm okay with that. It's a good thing, right? You don't understand. You try to share with people what it's like to be a Christian, to be born again, to be saved, and you try to share that with them all day long until they walk in and taste it of themselves, they'll never understand, they'll never know. I wish I had a pack of Ferrero Rochers with me right now. Do you know why, right? I did this in this church once, right? I had a pack of chocolate. How many people have a Ferrero Rocher? How many people have not? Okay, I got a few. See, this is great. Because you try to get those people, okay, try to explain to them what that tastes like. No, try.
Chocolate, nuts, and gooey center. It just kind of melts in your mouth.
Oh, it's chocolate. But it's got hazelnuts in it, man, it tastes wonderful. And you share that with them and they're like, yeah, that sounds great, but not today. It's the same way with the gospel, isn't it? What's great about that is I had a pack of Ferrero Rochers and the people who had never had one, I threw one to them, right? And then they opened them bad boys up and they ate them. And they were like, oh, you should have seen the light come on. Oh, this is great. This is good, right? This is really good stuff. Yeah, it's the same way with your gospel message of Christ in your heart and what he's done for you in your life. You try to share all day long what he's done for you and what he's led you out of and how good it tastes and what he's led you out of it to and all the things that he's done for you, and you share it with them, and what do they say? Yeah, not today. It's unfortunate. God has to wet their spirits, amen? The Lord's word has to come live in them. And for them to come to the realization, they have to come and open the package and what? And eat it themselves. Taste and see that the Lord is good. The word within them, the disciples, is fulfilled. And listen, and so are they. That's the only thing that's ever going to bring fulfillment in your life. It's for Christ to come alive in you. Do you want fulfillment in life? Do you really want it? Then Jesus, the Word of God, must be revealed to you and within you. The word fully open to you not only brings fulfillment, but it carries with it a new openness of your soul for all that is of God. It rouses your faculty of understanding Him, understanding His word, understanding His ways. And look, it brings with it a desire to learn. Don't you want to learn? How are we ever going to become what God wants us to be if we never want to learn from Him Himself? One of the great joys of being a Christian is the fact of the promise that Jesus gave to us that the Holy Spirit would come and reveal to our hearts and minds all the things that He speaks to Him. I love the scripture says, no longer will another man teach another man, for they will all be taught by God. Isn't that who you want? I don't want you to hear me. I mean that with all my heart. I don't want you to hear me. I want you to hear Him. I want you to hear His voice. I want you to hear Him. It's one of the things I look for when I listen to other preachers and read their sermons. Am I hearing them or am I hearing the Lord behind them? If I'm hearing the Lord behind them, I'll keep reading. If I don't, I'm done. Because I want to hear Jesus. Where did you get that from? Where did you get that from? Why do you believe what you believe? Where'd you get that from? What are you talking about, Chuck? Why do you believe what you believe? I believe that. You know, it's sometimes I believe what I believe because someone else told me so. I saw it on TV. You know my favorite story with this, right? The three wise men, birth of Christ, me and Steve Bailey cruising in the car. Hey, Chuck, how many wise men at the birth of Christ? And I said, three. And why do you say that? I said, man, I've seen Charlie Brown. I've seen the postcards, you know, you go up to a house, what do you see on the lawn? Right. He goes, yeah, but what's the Bible say? I don't know, Steve, what's the Bible say? Wise men from the east came bearing gifts of frankincense, gold, and myrrh. Right? I was like, so we really don't, he goes, how many wise men are there? I was like, it really doesn't say, does it? He goes, but we know three gifts. I get the association. Agreed. The things that we think and believe really aren't what? True. Because we've been taught that way the whole time. Why do you believe what you believe? Is it because someone's fed you this? Or is it because you've actually got into the Word for yourself to figure it out? Oh, is the Word? One of my favorite questions is, am I getting into the Word, or is the Word getting into me? I want the opposite. Now, that doesn't mean that doesn't remove me from the fact I need to read the Word of God, but do I want to read the Word of God, or do I want the Word to read me? I want it to come to live in me. Why do you believe? Where'd you get that from? Why I say that is because sometimes one of my favorite ministers of all time is Charles Haddon Spurgeon. I love his sermons. Not because of him, because I hear Christ so strongly behind him and what he says. And I used to read his sermons. I couldn't understand that for a while. Why I was so drawn to his sermons and the things of him, right? What was it that was drawing me there? It was because I heard the voice of Christ. And I began to ask myself this question as I would read really cool things he would say. Like what, Chuck? Like one day, he was coming down the steps and he tripped and fell and he knocked out all his front teeth. And you know what he did? He jumped up and went, aha! Painless dentistry! That's crazy, man. But it was funny. What does it have to do with anything? When I read the things within Spurgeon's sermons that just spoke to my heart, I began to ask this question, where did you get that from? You know where he got it from? Not from another man. He got it from the Spirit of the Lord. He got it from God. Look, as you study the Word, look for that. What is the Lord speaking to you? Go ahead, Wayne.
Scripture goes along with that. The first John's test all the spirits to see whether or not they're from God.
Amen. Yes. Know his voice, amen. And she knows his voice.
Amen.
Know his voice.
I think, I'll read this again. The Word fully open to you not only brings fulfillment, it carries with it a new openness of your soul for all that is of God. It rouses your faculty of trying to understand Him, His Word, His ways, and brings with it a desire to learn. I think even more so is to learn in order to share the living Christ, the very living Word of God within you. What did you just say, Chuck? Yes, you get a hold of it so that you are able to then what? Share what is inside of you. See, the Spirit of God comes into your life. It brings with you wonderful things. Galatians 5:22, for the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and self-control, right? So the Holy Spirit brings with it, it bears fruit in you. Well, fruit isn't designed for who? This is my favorite time of the year, is harvest time. I get all these peaches and nectarines and grapes and all this stuff growing on my trees, and guess what I get to do? I get to share it. I get to share it. It's so much fun to share, right? I get to eat it too, but it's so much more fun to give it to other people. See, the Holy Spirit is designing things and producing things within you in order for you to share it. Glorious, glorious, glorious risen Lord. Glorious risen Christ. Come, speak to us. Come, open our hearts and our minds to you. Come, give us understanding and create within us a desire to want to learn. Our hope of glory. Come, come, live within us and make us your abode. Come, come into my life. Jesus spoke these things and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come, glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Even as you gave him authority over all flesh, that to all with whom you've given him, he may give eternal life. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. That is a powerful scripture. Colossians 1:21-29. In that salvation point, and although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, although you were engaged in evil deeds, yet he has now reconciled you, and that's Chuck Snyder, that's me, in his fleshly body through death, in order to present you before him holy and blameless beyond all reproach. If indeed you continue in the faith firmly established and steadfast and not moved away from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven, of which I, Paul, was made a minister. Now rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I do my share on behalf of his body, which is his church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. Of this church I was made a minister according to the stewardship from God bestowed on me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. That is, the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but has now been manifested or revealed to who? Raise your hand. Manifested, so he's opened it up to who? Oh, you are his saints. To whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is what? Christ in you. Oh, listen to me, saints. Don't pass up on those words right there. That those four words right there, the hope of... Oh, Chuck, are you telling me... Listen to me. Do you realize that God's glory has hope? Think about it. Let that sink in for a moment. What is hope? What is hope? Say it very...
A confident expectation.
It's not a, I think so.
A confident expectation.
It's a confident expectation. God's glory has a confident expectation for you. God's glory does. God's glory has a confident expectation for you. We proclaim him. We admonish him and every man, right? And teaching every man with all wisdom so that we may present every man complete in Christ. What do you think the hope of God's glory is for you? That's it right there. That you might what? Come to Christ. That you may what? Fully understand him. That you may be able to grasp everything that he's given to you in order for you to be the Christian that he wants you to be. Amen? For this purpose also I labor, striving according to his power, which mightily works in me. Jesus himself is risen from the dead. May he come to live within all those who hear his words and those to whom he chooses to reveal himself to. Deep down inside, each one of us knows it's anyone and everyone who will do so. Amen? He wants everyone to come to him, but they still have a choice. 1 Timothy 1:12 through 17. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has strengthened me because he considered me faithful, putting me into service. He's put you into service too. Do you know that? Even though I was formerly a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent aggressor, what's he sharing? Exactly what Beth was sharing earlier. Right? Who she was. Oh, but let's not leave it there. I was formerly. That means what? That was my past. A blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent aggressor. Yet I was shown mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was more than abundant with the faith and love, which are found in who? Christ Jesus. It is a trustworthy statement, deserving full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners. That's me and you, among whom I am the foremost of all. Yet for this reason, even though I was the worst, I found mercy. Mercy is what? All these tests. Mercy is what? Oh, seeing a need and being able to meet that need. Who? Look, when it comes to your sins, only one person has the ability to see that need and meet that need. That's God. Does it make sense? Okay. Yet for this reason I found mercy, so that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example for those who would believe in him for eternal life. That's me and you. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. One more portion of scripture. Romans 10, 6 through 15. But the righteousness based on faith speaks as follows. Do not say in your heart who will ascend into heaven. That is to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the deep. That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we are preaching. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's salvation. For with the heart a person believes, you believe it in your heart, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. You can't get away from it. Okay? There's no getting away from this. That's not what I say, it's what the scripture says. If you really believe it in your heart, what will you do? You'll say it with your mouth. And the confessing and the belief of it, what do you become? You become born again. You become saved. That's how we all come to salvation. Amen? For the Scripture says, whoever believes in Him will not be, you're not going to be disappointed at all. For there is no distinction between Jew or Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on Him. I'm required to call on Him. And then guess what He does? He calls on me. He calls on you. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on Him in whom they have not believed? And how will they believe in Him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? How will they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. That's what you do when you share with your neighbors. That's what you do when you share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Look, may you hear Him speak to you. Even more so, may Jesus Christ, the very Word of God, come to live within you. Because that's the hope. Christ in you. Christ in you. The hope of glory. May you find Him hearing His voice behind you, but even more so, may you find Him living within you. Any other thoughts? Any other scriptures? Go before the Lord. Most gracious and Heavenly Father, we just thank You so much for today. We thank You for the awesomeness of Your Son Jesus. Thank You for the promise of the Spirit and the fact that Your Son comes to live in us, Lord. Come, make Your abode in us. Dwell within us, Lord, that we truly might hear Your voice and know Your voice. Train us to know it, Lord. And when we hear those voices, to move in the direction that You would have us. Father, I trust with all my heart that the things that You would speak to us would never lead us into sin. It would never lead us to do anything wrong. And we just trust You and believe You for this, Lord. Lord, for those who do not know You, Father, we pray that Your Word would come to live in them. Lord, that the Word that has been sown in their hearts would contain with it the Spirit to move their hearts. And Lord, that You would call their names and bring them to their knees, that they might believe You, confess with their mouth, and so be saved. We trust You for this, Lord, and we believe it. Your gospel, Your Word, still works. Only speak to us, Lord. Speak to us and rise up in our hearts. Come to live in us, Lord. Raise us from the dead. We trust You for it. We believe You for it. It's in Christ's name we pray, and everybody said, Amen. Amen.
Tempted and tried, we're often made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never cheer up my brother, live in the sunshine, we'll understand. Comes down from his home in the sky.